Good morning, everyone, and welcome on the Sunrise Safari. My name's Brent. I've got Phil on camera, and with James and Andrew on the other vehicle, and Tara and Eugene in final control. Welcome to a very chilly Juma private game zone. It's 14 degrees Celsius, about 52 degrees Fahrenheit. Well, an exciting morning ahead. Phil and I have headed out to try and find those lions again, specifically those sticks, lionesses. Because we're not sure where they're hiding, those three little tiny cubs at the moment. But while we've stopped here waiting to start, I've just heard a pride of lions, sounds like definitely more than two, calling to the north of us. Possibly the Nkuhuma, judging from where I heard that they were yesterday. So we're going to have a quick look down here, and then we're going to shoot up there to see if we can find those lions that are calling. They sound like they might be in the Buffleshook Dam area, but they could be a little bit further north. But maybe they're on the move in this very cold morning. For those of you who are new, welcome. We're on a live African safari. You're sitting on the back of my vehicle. You're seeing everything at the same time I'm seeing it. And we're also interactive, so you can ask us questions about what we're seeing in the bush. And you can do that by emailing us, questions@wildearth.tv. Or you can use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. So welcome. And to all our regulars, nice to have you with us as always. And let's go try find some kitty cats.
Standing by, James. The morning mobile stations just had audio of, sounds like, pride of Angola.
Towards Buffleshook Dam,
possibly north of Burchell boundary. We'll be following up.
So, very interesting. For those of you who might have missed the two, the sunrise and sunset safaris yesterday, we've had. Oh, sorry, one second. Busy on the radio as we get going. Standing by.
Copy, thanks very much. Yeah, then I'm going to head back towards Buffleshook Dam. Copy, thanks very much, Andrew. So guys, just got a quick update from Andrew in the east, and he just said that they have already found one of the Matimba males and one of the Styx lionesses. Towards the east of us, off our Travis area. So I think our best chance is to head towards where we heard those lions calling. So let's go have a look. And guys, I'm about to go through a drainage line, so sometimes we get a bit of a signal dip, so bear with me if we do. Down here in these drainage lines. So while we're out, we're not only looking for the lions and the leopards and the elephants, we're definitely keeping an eye out for all the small things that might catch our eye as we travel. Generally for the first hour of a sunrise safari, it's the best time to possibly find some of those cats on the move while it's still cool. And as we can hear, we just heard lions roaring, so it is the best time to focus on finding the cats. But we will always keep a lookout for everything else. be a very crisp morning. Some beautiful colors around as the sun starts to peek up towards the horizon. And the dry season and our cold season is well and truly set now. Quite interesting where we were watching those two sticks lionesses last night when they were scent marking. They moved into an area that's very much traditionally been part of the Inkahuma pride's territory. There is always some overlap on lion territories. The boundaries are not sort of that big electric fence that no one crosses. So, very interesting to see what happens with lions in an area when we spend such an extended time like we do here. Towards that last sound of the lions, we're going to cross to James, who I'm sure is just as cold as me, probably a bit colder in his short shorts, and we will be back with you a little later in the drive.
Hello everyone, it's chilly out here this morning. Welcome to Wendy. We have gone terra incognito to the west in this African dawn. The sun has yet to peep over the horizon where we are. Andrew is behind camera. I can't even describe what he looks like today, the amount of clothing he has on. He does have some fairly skinny legs sticking out the bottom of his shorts. They might be skinnier than mine even, which is quite something. Back in the control room, I'm sure as you're aware, we have Eugene and Tara drinking coffee and staying warm and using their brains rather than their hands, as we are today. And Brent and Phil are following the lions. So, welcome to it. We love having your comments. Please remember that. We love having your comments and your questions. Hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. Our plan this morning is to go and check. Apparently, Cam, the Zoomie, thank you for your update. You had some lions that were audible from the camera at the Arathusa Dam and also apparently some elephants at 4 a.m. That's quite a long time ago. I was mercifully in my bed by that time of the morning. But we're going to follow up there. I would really like to see some elephants today. So that's what we're going to try and find while Brent follows the lions. And who knows what else we'll see. You may notice that it is something of an effort for me to keep my lips moving in the sort of temperature. So I'm going to practice the name of a plant. Andrew, if you could pan over to the right slightly. There's a scraggly plant here, just over there. That's it, that scraggly thing that you have in picture now. Extremely exciting first sighting for the day. That plant, everybody, is called the caterpillar bush. But its Latin name is Ormocarpum tripocarpum. And so, when one is cold in the morning, one must find a Latin name that makes one's lips move. Ormocarpum tripocarpum is quite a good one. So you can all say that repeatedly while I drive along. It's quite an interesting bush in that it doesn't... That's about as big as it gets out here because of the elephants. The elephants really love it. Outside of the areas where there are elephants, it gets much, much larger than that. Right, on our quest for the elephants we go. Let's see what we can find. Like I say, a little chillsome. Looking forward to the sun peeping over the horizon.
Mm.
can just see, Andrew, if you can focus in on the horizon there, maybe, just as we drive along, that darkness there that you can see, I like to think of that as the night being chased down beyond the mountains. You can see that darkness, that's not the mountains, that is actually remnants of the night about to be chased over the horizon with the new dawning of the African day. Remember that we're sitting on about 3.5 million hectares of contiguous wildlife land, and this is roughly the same size, or no, it's not, it's almost twice the size of Israel, twice the size of Wales. It's about half the size, no, it's not, it's less than that, about half the size of North Carolina, apparently. So that's not bad. And our little spot, there is... it was a duiker, sorry. It got... For a minute there, I thought it was a wild dog. I think my eyes need to wake up a bit. But it is, in fact, a duiker. So our little section is about 1,500 hectares. And that's what we're going to be searching on. Seem to be two lion prides moving around here at the moment, which is quite unusual for a piece of land that size. And we'll also hopefully find some leopards some stage during the day. There's the duiker. Now they don't normally let us look at them for any length of time before diving or daking off into the bush. That's a really nice one. So the norm used to be called the grey duiker, but you can see that one's quite brown. And so they're now known as the common duiker. Nice. You can hear some monkeys alarm calling in the far distance. And all around this sort of winter dawn chorus, which is a bit more, there he goes, diving away. And the dawn chorus today is a bit more subdued than it is in the summer. Right. Carry on. Stunning morning this. It is a little chilly, but I think it's going to warm up nicely. So the dawn chorus in the winter is a little more subdued, it's a little more subtle, because none of the birds are trying to mate. And a large portion of the calls, bird calls that we hear, have to do with their desire and need to mate and the attraction of mates. A bit like those of us who play music initially started to do so because we thought it might attract girls. In my case, that hasn't been particularly successful. In Mick Jagger's case, it has. Looking for rather hopefully for a termite mound with an opening. On mornings like this you can often see steam coming out of them, which is nice to see, and it's also a great place to try and warm your hands. Andrew has left his gloves behind, or lost them, And so he's actually, the ends of his fingers are starting to turn blue. Might have to amputate at the end of the drive. That's all right. So we're approaching the Arathusa airstrip at the moment. I'm hoping that there'll be something that they've decided that wants to be in the clearing at this time of the day. Myself for what I'm about to do. Normally the most twee sort of thing that a guide can tell his guests about is the toothbrush tree, because every guide tells every guest about the toothbrush tree, but I have in fact left or forgotten my toothbrush where I stayed last night, two nights ago. And so therefore, I must create my own. Now, I'm sure some of you have seen this before, but some may not have. This is the magic worry, or Euclea divinorum. And I need a toothbrush. So you clear the bark off like an elephant. Now we make bristles. Now we clean our teeth. This, of course, results in bleeding of the gums, because you're essentially sticking spines into your gums. But actually it has quite a fresh minty feel. Not bad. I've actually never used it that effectively before. So, thanks for excusing my morning toilet. On we go. Very angry crowned lapwings you can hear. Brandy, welcome to the African Dawn. I'm just going to line Andrew up so he can take a picture of it for you. Brandy, Homocarpum tripocarpum is called such. Is that all right, Andrew?
Perfect.
There comes the sun. Its common name for the caterpillar bush comes from the pods, which look like little hairy caterpillars, and there aren't any around really at this time of the year. So, unfortunately, I can't really show you one. I might be able to find one at the next one. We find apparently are some wild dogs being tracked around this area. Quite a few vehicles around, so we're just going to hope we bump into them at some stage. They are heading in this direction, apparently. Nice to just stop and listen for a while. I'm just going to be silent for the next 20 seconds and see what we hear. bearded woodpecker doing his territorial tap. Andrew, can we sneak along a little bit here? There are quite a few birds, and I know we had a request yesterday for Swainson's francolin, and so we'll just go a little bit along the airstrip here, and I did see a Swainson's francolin. Andrew, can you see it? It's just popping out there. Just popping out there. It's in that little ditch. See that? Got him there. He's now almost invisible. He'll pop out now, I hope. If he doesn't, I'll chase him out. You can see the hornbill there, and they're shouting lapwing. The Swainson's francolin is just behind that. But it's not visible at the moment. But there are a whole lot more. Sorry, Andrew, we'll just sneak slowly forward. Thanks, Bugsy and James, for your comments on my toothbrush cleaning. It didn't taste like any leopards had marked their territories there. Thank you for your concern. And yes, I have brushed my teeth since I ate dung yesterday. Thank you for that. Now, those are the Swainson's francolin. You see their red faces? Those are youngsters, so they don't have very red faces. And the lapwings are going ballistic because they've probably got a little nest quite nearby. And they're they're now chasing the burchell starlings around the place. I find it strange that they would have a nest at this time of the year, but it's certainly not impossible. Andrew will try and get one of them now. There he is, yelling his head off. Very attractive little birds. And what they'll do like that is, if you are near a nest, they'll call. One of them will call and almost just sort of attract you away from it. So a predator would be attracted to the most obvious thing it could, and that would be the one calling next to the nest. And so he'll walk away from the nest and call and sort of attract the predator's attention away. It's quite clever. Starlings calling in the background. Let's just see those little Swainson's francolins picking up seeds that they can find, and possibly the odd little insect. That's a flock of that's a big flock of burchell starlings, and in fact it's a mixed starling flock and a whole lot of long-tailed or magpie shrikes. The starlings don't flock but in the winter time in South Africa. I'm not sure why. It's quite interesting. All congregating on that scraggly marula tree because it's the highest point in the area and they can get a bit of sun when the sun comes up. There it comes. All right, Andrew, let's press on slightly. See what we can see. I think we're going to head towards the Arathusa waterhole. See if we can't spot. That's where the elephants were at 4 a.m. They won't be there now, but they might be between here and there. You'd like to know about the airstrip and how often planes land here. They'd probably get a plane here once a day, sometimes once every 2 days. And I'll get back to you now. Are you? How are you? Good. Is it cold?
The guys are following up on Bachelor's Wonder.
Yes.
It sounds like they're, you know, with the BET blockers. Okay. Somewhere around there. So it's just crossed off the cut line, unfortunately.
Okay.
Right in front of us.
All right. Cool. Thanks. Have a good drive. Enjoy. Don't freeze. Right. So, the aeroplanes come in probably once a day, sometimes once every 2 days. People can drive into this area too. So, you know, some guests like to fly, some guests like to drive. It's a bit cheaper to drive. And in terms of warning, well, yes, planes do radio ahead to the lodges to tell us that they're coming. And we'd normally then come up to this sort of area, just check that the area is clear of any form of animal life. You don't want an aeroplane landing on an impala. And yeah, so that's the sort of warning that we get. And I mean, on a clear day like today, you'll see and hear them coming from a long way off. Normally on this airstrip, it's a plane called a caravan, which is a sort of 12-seater Cessna. Perfect sort of bush plane, lands in very little, needs very little ground to land. And then they can, an airstrip like this will take something as large as a, I think it's a Beechcraft 1900, which is a sort of 20-seater, like a big King Air. Wisconsin. I imagine Wisconsin gets quite a lot colder than we are right now, but that you are possibly, hopefully, warmer than we are right now. You'd like to know, if I understand, and whether it was all local. Yes, it was all local. At a very old school, and then I went to university in Pietermaritzburg for the first stint, and after that I went to Cape Town for my second stint. But all local. Just get out of the way here for these fine fellows in search of animals. Are you? Morning.
Hey.
How's it going?
Yeah.
Good. Fine. Any luck?
Nothing?
Okay. Right, well.
You guys drive Shirley's?
No, not you. I don't think so. Are we on Shirley's? Okay, cool. We're a bit clueless.
We're this road, yeah.
Okay. Okay, cool. All right, see you. Enjoy your drive. It's like a veritable highway out here. Let's have a little stop here. I have something going on. This plant here, I'm just going to jump out of the car quickly, but it's that scraggly thing in front of us there, Andrew. I suppose I should turn the vehicle off before I get out. You also might like to note that I have two different kinds of mittens on today. One is Brent's, the other is Scott's. I think Scott must have got this when he was about 4 years old. So Brent calls this dwarf wild saffron. I've yet to find a reference to that form of plant in any book, so I've told him that he's made it up. Of course, he got very offended by that and chased me with a stick. But I think it's something called Venonia. But what is indisputable is the amazing smell. And if it is called a dwarf wild sage, it's from this incredible smell. And there are lots of these sort of aromatic plants that grow along verges or along any disturbed area, and they're sort of what we call a pioneer species. So before grasses will take over, these are the sorts of plants that will come in. And they're aromatic like this, not because it's nice for us to cook with them or drive past and have a smell at them, but because those aromatic oils tend to be very offensive to grazers, so they can survive in disturbed areas that have been overgrazed or perhaps driven over by vehicles a lot, and that's why they grow next to the side of the road quite often. And you'll find this all in many parts of the world. If you're driving through North America or even in Europe, if you pick some of the what we call pioneer vegetation, you can see it's pioneer vegetation. It looks quite weedy and it looks quite looks like it won't be there for long. If you pick some of that often and smell the leaves, you'll often find that they're I can hear a hippo calling in the background. You'll often find that they are aromatic and kind of a smelly, full of oil. That is Venonia. Right, back we get, plug ourselves in so that Tara can speak to me, or you can speak to me via Tara. Cover my fingers. Off we go. Turn the radio so I can hear what's going on.
Welcome back, everyone. Sorry about that very quick transition. We've got quite an interesting little bird species here. We're going to have a try and get a proper look at them now. But welcome back. Cold. Unfortunately, the lions are calling to the north of our traverse here. So we're looking at some of the smaller things now. Where'd they disappear to? Let me just scoop forward a skirsh. See if we can get another view of them. So I'm going to ask you to identify this for me. And depending on the one we focus on, just trying to see where they are. There's some just in front of us. Oh, it's going to be a bit of a difficult bird test because of where they're moving, but I'm sure you guys are up to the challenge. Just moved through. Let me try again. We're moving in some shorter grass, so it might be a little bit easier. Zoop around. which bird species is this? And let's have a look at the one we're going to get in shot now. There we go. And is it a male or a female? We'll keep on them for a little bit. It is going to be quite a tough challenge. So they are scurrying about in the grass. They might come onto the open a little bit now. There we go. And you can send your answers to questions at wildearth.tv, or you can use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. What bird species is this? And is this a male or a female? So there's a whole little covey of them feeding on the grass seeds early in the morning. Morning, morning, everyone. How are you doing? Good. Nyoni, birds. We're looking at some birds. Enjoy, good luck. So, Ephraim's just passing. Oh, we've already got an answer, and you guys are fast this morning. Well, first answer in, although being fast, is not correct. We've had Swainson's Franklin in, that's not correct. But it is a Franklin, so on the right track. Let's see if we can get one last glimpse at them. Moved into the longer grass. Oh, we've had another one in, says Shelley's Franklin. Closer, but still not quite cigar. So also had it says female. It is a female, but it's not a Shelley's. They do look quite similar than to a female Shelley's, but they are a bit smaller. I think they've trying to see if we can spot the male. The male's a bit of a dead giveaway. That's why we decided to show you the female first. It's my second favorite Franklin species in this area. Like they've all done a disappearing act. I'm just going to get the book ready. I can still hear a few of them. Oh, there they are. Let's see if we can see the male. Well done to George Ann in Illinois. Who's got it? It is a compared to the ladies. I'm just trying to see him. I did see him a little bit earlier. We've got the ladies here still. Just trying to spot the male. Female. You can actually hear them moving through the leaf litter. Every now and then they do these wonderful little conch tad calls to each other, just to make sure that the whole covey is together. And if we we wait a little bit longer, that male might move out of that thicket at the back. I'm keeping my eye out. There's probably about 7 or 8 in this little covey. Watching for the male now. He's at the back, just to the left of where you are there, Phil. He might pop up. There's another female. It doesn't look like the male's being very helpful this morning. Anyway, we can show you what he looks like in the book. Phil thinks he might have spotted him behind there. Let's have a look whether that's the male. Aha. Is that him? I can't see just yet. There we go. There's the male. You know, that very sort of dark crown and sort of rufous or orange, almost a burnt amber orange head. Very, very pretty little bird. The smallest of the Franklin species that we get here. Good spot, Phil. There we go, you can see that head of his and it disappears. Okay, as they move along, I'll show you so you can have a nice comparison in the book. So there we go. Number 3 here. Cokie Franklin. So there's the male. You can see that really nice burnt orange head with a darker brown cap. And then the female with those beautiful white and black facial markings. The reason you can get confused with the Shelleys is you can see they do have that, also have that white sort of throat around and black around the throat. They're quite a lot bigger and they don't have that such intricately detailed lining on their face. And the Cokie's call is quite an interesting one. It's a, I'm going to play it for you now. So he's said to say, Cokie, Cokie, Cokie. So that's where he gets his name from. Cokie, Cokie. So maybe a bit, turn it up a bit. Apparently we had a few little sound issues with the satellites. We apologize profusely for that. And for those of you who missed it, that was a Cokie Franklin. I'll do the call one more time. So it's said to say that they say Cokie, Cokie, Cokie. So let's see what you think, if you agree. There we go, a Cokie Franklin, one of my favorite little guys. So I just heard an update on the Game Drive radio. I just want to double check. It's off our property line. Just double check if that sounds like it's coming towards us. Well, anyway, there. Quite far away, so we're going to head on down to the sort of northwest corner where we had that last report of Sindile. Check the boundaries here. The lines have definitely crossed out. So we're going to head at the moment we're heading almost due west. Warming up a bit. Bob's that's Matimba. Do you think he will cross south? Okay, copy. Thanks very much, Ops. Maybe not quite warm enough to let go of my gloves just yet. But a beautiful winter's morning. How the temperature changes as we drop up and down through these little tips. So definitely a degree or two cooler when we're at the base than when we're at the top of the ridge. But you can see on the skyline there that layer of sort of dust and smoke above the higher altitude in the blue sky, and that is very indicative of this time of the year. Very pastel color. Slowly meandering down this long straight road. We've got a nice tree in front of us here. So, very beautiful tree. Lovely light on it this morning. But quite a distinct tree. Not the most common tree we get in this area, but still a nice one. So, I'm going to put you guys to the test and see if you can identify what tree this is. Very distinct bark. So if you can identify this tree, you can let me know by emailing questions@wildearth.tv, or you can use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. And there will be bonus points for those of you who can find the Latin or scientific name for this tree. This could be a little bit difficult, so I've just spotted something that I don't think we've ever really looked at before on a drive. So I'm just going to try reposition the vehicle so you guys can have a good look at it. And this will be the second part of the test this morning. She's just seen something else as well. Just give me half a sec there, guys. There's male leopard tracks here as well. But let's start. They don't look that fresh. From here, I'm going to show you what I'm looking at now from. tiny, 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 tiny tracks. Can you get them there? Screen. There we go. I'm just going to try to find something to give you reference to size with these things. Let me just take my binoculars. Let's try those ones, yeah. Those look like we can see them a bit clearer. Okay, let's have a look. So I'm just going to pop my binoculars next to them for size reference. So you can see how incredibly tiny those tracks are. Minute. And I don't think we've ever really looked at tracks this size. We've always stuck with the bigger ones. But so I'm going to give you a double question to work on while we move down there. Obviously, there's the tree. And then what could possibly have made these tiny, tiny tracks? I'm going to put my finger there as well, just so you can see. What could have possibly made these tiny, tiny tracks in the road during the night? So you could see there that literally the one track is smaller than the track was made by me just touching my finger in the sand. So a minute little animal. But quite interesting to have a look, see if you guys can figure out what that tiny thing is. Let's continue on. So, first couple of answers in for the trees, and unfortunately, no one's got them right yet. We had a marula and leadwood, neither of which are correct. And if we have a look, there's actually a magpie shrike sitting in a smaller version of that tree. Same species of tree, just a little bit of a smaller one. But with magpie shrike at the top. And getting warm in that nice early morning light sitting on top. Let you have another look at that tree with the magpie shrike in it. So we've had a few answers for the tracks as well. Genet, civet, mongoose. Unfortunately, none of those are quite correct. Morning, morning. So I'm just going to go through a dip here as we possibly have a little bit of signal issue, but I'm going to shoot straight through it. So I think everyone's thinking a little bit big from what I'm hearing on the tracks. Just remember, that track was smaller than what the mark I can make with my index finger. are we now getting to a closer? We got Jeffrey. Well done, Jeffrey, from Austin in Texas. He says it's a rat, which is, I'm going to accept, it's quite close. It's, to me, it looks more like a gerbil, a bushveld gerbil, which is quite a big-sized rodent in this area. So probably fits in the palm of my hand. And if you take my binoculars, for example, there, but I mean, probably about this big and quite funny. And I can tell it's a gerbil from the tracks rather than anything else. So the way they move, he sort of spends a bit of time up on his front, on his back legs, and down, 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 and then back up, and down, 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 down. So well done, Jeffrey. That's correct. It is a rodent. Oh, well done to Gilly in Milwaukee, who also got it correct, and she guessed gerbil. Well done. It's nice to actually have a look at some of the really tiny things from time to time. And I just thought, I don't think anyone's actually ever stopped and looked at some gerbil tracks. So they were so nice and fresh in this crisp early morning that I thought it was definitely worth having a look. Like this is turning into a nearly impossible tree quiz. What I will do is I'll keep waiting for some more answers, then I'll go have a, I'm pretty sure on one of the next ridges there's one a bit close to the road, so we can actually get a branch and have a closer look. But keep trying, guys. Before then someone has got it right. I'm just waiting for a name. Joanne, Jewel, apple leaf, that is the correct answer. It's also sometimes known as a rain tree. I'm just going to go through this dip and I'll chat about it again once we're through. It's called an apple leaf. I grew up knowing it as a rain tree rather than an apple leaf, for a couple of reasons. It said that the leaves look very similar to that of an apple tree. I've never seen many apple trees, so I'm not sure about that. But the name I know it by is a rain tree, and there's two reasons for that. The one is that there's a very specific type of very small insect, especially towards the end of the dry seasons around October, November, called a spittle bug. And I think if I remember correctly, the one that feeds off the apple leaf is called a Tipuana spittle bug. I might not be 100% on that. That could be the weeping wattles one. I'll double check on that a little bit later. But what happens is this tiny little spittle bug, another nice name for them is a frog hopper beetle. So they've got very developed back legs, and they're shaped almost like a little, like a rose thorn, but not quite as sharp, obviously. But these hugely developed back legs enable them to spring vast distances for an insect of that size. And what they do is they suck the sap out of the leaves and the stems of the leaves of that tree at a rate of knots. And they almost expel a drop a second when there's a lot of them. And what that does is during some of the old days, people used to stop underneath those trees and they think it was raining.
Sorry, I just want to check. False alarm.
They would think it was raining from the drops from the spittle bug. Also, when the wind blows, the leaves, I'm going to see if I can find you some now. The leaves make a sound like rain on a tin roof. So one of my trees that reminds me a lot of my childhood, a lot more of them in northern Botswana than here. Also, one of the things you learn very quickly when you live in a place like northern Botswana is you never build your camp or your house under one of those trees. They are very prone to falling over. Just checking carefully now. I know there's some a little bit further along. Across to James while we try and move into that area where Sindile was last seen, and we'll try and find a branch of that apple leaf or rain tree for you so you can hear the noise, and we'll be back with you a little later and drive.
Hello everybody, welcome back to the recalcitrant Wendelin. Behind us is a waterbuck. Andrew, wake up. So we're just going to move very slowly. He thinks we haven't seen him, of course. The beautiful waterbuck bull there. I only noticed him as I turned round and looked into the lens. There he is. Stunning waterbuck bull. Nowhere near any water, of course. I'll just try and do a little bit of a turn around there. I don't think he's going to be particularly tolerant of us. Andrew, I want you to film me taking my pleasure. It's quite a chilly morning, as I've said, and what I like to do on a morning like this is find an exposed termite chimney and warm my hands above it. So let's see if we can do that now. No, this termite mound has been closed off, possibly to avoid the cold. It's while I remember to tell you. This grass has a wonderful name that I've mentioned before, and to those who haven't heard it, often grows on termite mounds. It's called Chlorus roxburghiana. Sounds a very rock and roll for a grass. Grass is not normally known for its rock and roll character, but Chlorus roxburghiana is the rock and roll Mick Jagger of the grass world. Right, let's press on. I have seen some elephant tracks, and so my plan now, or our plan, as we are planning together, is to try and see if we can't find them. I'm pretty sure that they're the same ones that came from the Arathusa waterhole at 4 o'clock this morning. That's where we followed them from. There has been a lot of activity in this area this morning though, so the tracks are not necessarily going to be that obvious, but I think there's a pretty good chance they're obviously around somewhere here. And this time of the day, they're more than likely feeding, so they won't be moving very fast, if at all. Right. Most of the termite mounds actually done today, I've checked quite a few of them, have been closed up, probably to maintain the heat inside. And if I find a warm one, I shall definitely stop. Andrew has stolen my blanket because he says he's colder up back than I am. I felt quite sympathetic. He might be the only person in the world I know who has thinner legs than mine. They're about as hairy though. So from animal-wise, it's been a pretty quiet morning, but we can just start to feel the edge of the cold coming off the atmosphere. The sun is just starting to warm the air, which is rather lovely. So after not too long, we'll be peeling off the layers. Get those southern black tits. I'm just going to stop here. It's quite a good idea, even if Andrew can't get them. I think he will get them though. In this bush there are two little birds called southern black tits. There we go. And what they do is they often indicate indicators of bird parties. There are often lots of other birds around them. In this case, it might be a sort of breakfast date that this pair is going on. There he is. Not easy to follow one of them. They're insect eaters, and so they will glean insects from leaves and from between the fissures in the bark of trees. And they'll just fly from tree to tree, and they're often followed by other sort of leaf gleaners, as we call them. The southern black tit. Not to be confused with a drongo. Grey crowned helmet shrikes here. You can get them, Andrew, they may fly. See if you can. There you go, well done. So that's a flock. I love these little birds. They're quite they've got quite a similar sort of social structure to wild dogs almost. They have a breeding pair, and the breeding pair will obviously lay a clutch of eggs and then start to raise them, and then they will keep that clutch of eggs with them for the duration of the next year, after which they'll kick them out and they'll go and form their own flocks. So they stay for a year, help raise the next clutch, and then move on. So in your first year of life as a grey-crowned helmet shrike, you have to help raise your brothers and sisters from the next year, and then you can go off and set up on your own. It's quite an interesting strategy. It's called communal nesting. So they'll move in flocks that breed together, or communal breeding, and there are not that many birds out here that will do that. They nest in tree holes, as far as I'm aware. And also little insect gleaners. That rather rasping call you can hear is the call of the grey-headed bush shrike. Grey-headed bush shrike is a beautiful bird who's got two calls. One of them is that horrible rasping one you've just heard, and the other one gives it its colloquial name. Its colloquial Afrikaans name, there it is there, Andrew. Number two is the grey-headed bush shrike. Beautiful bird. And its Afrikaans name is the spookvoel, which means ghost bird. And that's because of its other call, and it goes like this. Sounds eerily just like a ghost, doesn't it? There's quite a lot of little bird activity going on here. Possibly as a result of the presence of the southern black tit. No elephants as yet. Hit the hooter by mistake. Right, so there we have, sorry, there was a drongo there that has now flown off and disappeared. There he is. This is Andrew's favorite, to have to try and find birds that I spot. There, he's gone. But he's, what's interesting, I'm just going to sit here for a second, and if you listen. Okay, now the two birds that you can hear that are both drongos imitating other birds. There's a drongo doing a rattling cisticular call, and the one that we were trying to track was doing the white-browed scrub robin. It was doing a poor imitation, but it was definitely imitating that. And another one behind us doing the rattling cisticula.
Everyone, we've just been sitting and listening carefully, see if we could hear any alarm calls, and Phil was just having a look at that lilac-breasted roller sitting in a tree, getting some nice early morning light. We're going to continue on for a little bit now, see what else we can find. So we've been asked a question, and I'm going to get to it now, but during the drive today, I'm going to be hopping off the vehicle from time to time to collect certain tree species, and then we're going to go through them all together at the end. So the first one on my collection list is right here. There's the first one. I'm not going to tell you what it is yet, but we're going to collect all of them. Pop that down there. Warmed up quite a bit. I think I can lose my blankets and some of my other paraphernalia. So, you're more than welcome to have a gander at what tree that is while I collect. So there's another game we can play while I collect my different samples. You can try to figure out which tree this is. Have a quick look at the branch as well. There we go. See, it doesn't have true thorns, but it's got spines. And spines are basically branchlets that have changed in their adaption to protect the tree like a thorn would. But they're not true thorns, they are branches. But they are spines. And nice compound leaves. Oops, come back here. and there we go. Oh, look at that. Phil, do you see on the top of the monitor? It's a tiny little spider species. I'm not 100% sure what type, but it does look like one of the grass spiders. Can you see it there? Tiny little guy. I'm going to try and move out of the light so you can have a better look. A tiny little spider. Does look like one of the possible... Oh, I don't want to disturb him too much, and when I move to have a closer look, I'm afraid I block him out. I'm just like, come on. Oh, and jump down. Really, really beautiful, or more comfortable for me at least, and have to feel like I'm a snowman. Leads up to Sydney's dam. Let's see what's happening here this morning. Just a lot of hippos in the water by the looks of things. We saw a whole heap of them basking here. I think it was yesterday's sunset safari, so I'm quite sure as it warms up, I think at the moment they're probably warmer in the water than they would be on the bank, but as the sun warms up, I'm quite sure you're going to find quite a few of them basking in the glorious winter sun. Don't worry, I haven't forgotten. I'm still keeping my eyes open for a nice rain tree or apple leaf. So we are in the general area that we had that report about Sindile. Now, this is just to confuse me, obviously. There are lion tracks here. Because they've been found to the north of us already, and it definitely wouldn't be the stakes because they've been found to the south of us, and we're right in the western northwestern corner, so I wonder which lions this could be. So lots of big elephant pods and hippo pods coming to and from the water there. So always a good spot to look for tracks. Quite a few elephants passed through here during the night, and some buffalo. If I just show everyone here quickly. So, some ellie tracks, buffalo tracks, all moving up and down between the water during the night. These ellies are proving to be quite elusive at the moment. those of you who've been watching for a while, this is the area that Steph, Scott and myself dubbed the black hole. So we had so many tracks coming in here, but we had great difficulty finding anything while we were here. So hopefully it has changed and it is now a beacon of shining light. Just a quick update from Commander Bond. He has got all your messages. He is aware and he is on standby. So fingers crossed. I'm not going to reveal for what just yet, but fingers crossed that you are able to join James for a very exciting surprise. I'm just checking this main road. We saw those, I saw a single track of a lioness over there, which I found very confusing. I just want to see if they've come through onto this other main road. And also this is the last area in this sort of area like this where Cindelia was spotted. Heard a squirrel alarming. He is playing tricks on me today. Is that they get quite a few corrugations, so we'll try avoid them as much as possible. Michigan. James has been chatting about what type of aeroplanes would land on the Arathusa airstrip, and Gail would now like to know whether Scott, James or myself are in the possession of a pilot's license. Unfortunately not, none of us do. The closest thing I can say to myself having a pilot's license is my mom. My mom is a pilot and she used to fly those little bush planes in northern Botswana.
So that's the closest. For me, this didn't really appeal to me. I like driving. I would like to get my microlite license on the other hand. Still haven't seen any tracks. It's possible he stayed in this these quarry thickets to the east of us here. Out for some more trees to collect for a very specific question that we'll get to a little bit later in the safari. And here is the next one. So it's going to be a while before we get to that quiz. There's still quite a few other little tree species I'd like to collect. So while we continue to search for Sindile and some trees, and we're going to pass across to James and see what Commander Bond has been up to.
Everybody, as you know, many of you have seen the wild dogs on the Arathusa camera, and the bad news is that they have headed south out of an area that we are allowed to go into, so unfortunately we can't follow them. There are about 7,000 vehicles trying to follow them at the moment, so I'm not actually that upset about it, but for the fact that I wanted to see them. We're going to hang around in and around the general area in case they do turn and come north. It's not impossible. I'm going to head towards that airstrip where we were earlier and see if they don't pop out there. Sorry, one second. Okay, anyway, and what's important to notice is that the apparently so there have been a lot of questions about whether the gravid female has given birth or not. We saw her last about a week and a half to 2 weeks ago, I think a week and a half ago, and she was looking like she was about to give birth. So I think it's quite likely that she has. We haven't seen or heard of her giving birth yet, but I suspect quite strongly that the pack would have found a termite mound with a hole in it and she would have given birth there. So that's the story there. Okay, we're going to head towards that airstrip and we might be lucky, they might pop out there. Okay, thanks. There's lots of noise going on the radio, so if I suddenly start speaking nonsense, it's because my brain is unable to speak to you and listen to the incessant chatter in my ear from the other game drives trying to follow the dogs. Right. Andrew is in tears. I'm in tears. I'm sure you're all in tears. Take my gloves off, don't care if my hands freeze. It has warmed up quite a lot, which is very nice. But to miss the wild dogs is a sadness. going to have a quick listen and just check on my map as to where they are. I can hear where they are and make sure they aren't coming north. No, it would seem that they are not. The elephant tracks, I'm afraid, also cross north out of our area, but there were reports of another herd around this area where we are now, so I'm kind of hoping we might pick some up there. And to drive a little bit quicker, just in case they do pop out onto the airstrip. You ask a very interesting question, and I'm not sure that I can answer it. You want to know why it is that a fork-tailed drongo has a forked tail. Just trying to think if it confers any flight advantage. I don't believe that it does confer any flight advantage. You know, there are a lot of bird designs that are decorative. And they're decorative for the purposes of attracting females. And so sometimes there are some sort of what we call sexually dimorphic characteristics, except, now I'm talking rubbish now, because the females also have a forked tail. William, I don't know why drongos have a forked tail. I'm going to have to plead ignorance on that one. You do get a square-tailed drongo, which has a pretty square tail. So I'm afraid I don't know. Very good question. I'll try and find out. Ranga from Tasmania. That's a long way from where we are now. Probably quite chilly. Home of Ricky Ponting. You want to know what kind of temperatures the termite mounds will make that will allow us to warm our hands. The answer is about 37 degrees. And they generally maintain a temperature of around that. They're quite humid. But that temperature is a good temperature for the fungus that they grow, and that's what they eat. And it's also a good temperature for any sort of metabolic process. That's why it's the temperature that we and most mammals sit at. Another lovely birding question. You're obviously an ornithologist of some repute. You'd like to know, are there any birds in the area that are more agile than other birds? The answer is yes and no. So in terms of, if we think of people that are agile or not agile, it's generally got to do with some sort of physical defect or some sort of physical advantage. But birds are as agile as they need to be. So if we look at something like a batalea, which has got no tail, it's not particularly agile, but it can fly very low, and its strategy is not built around being agile. Then if we look at a crowned eagle or a black sparrowhawk, which got a long tail and specifically designed for speed, they will nip through the branches at great speed and be able to turn on a tickie, and so you'd describe them as pretty agile. Then if you look at something like a falcon, it's pretty agile, But its wings are designed so that it can dive at great speed and then swoop up again. A swift is incredibly agile, but not particularly stable. So lots of different bird designs and various kind of agilities. But remember that a bird is only not agile out here because it doesn't need to be. Unlike a human being, which, you know, we tend to be, because of our sedentary lifestyle, we tend to lose our agility pretty much as soon as we stop being children. Unless we're professional athletes. And if you'd ever seen Andrew and I on the touch field, or the touch rugby field, you'd know that we weren't professional athletes. Sorry about the bumps. Hold on. Don't spill your coffee. Trying to follow what's going on with that sighting on the radio, but it sounds to me like it's almost gone silent, and I think that's because they've crossed onto another reserve where they use a different channel. But at least some of you got to see them on the Arathusa Cam. That's more than Andrew and I got. Of antelope. If they've run through here, it's so interesting, you know, when you watch, if an impala sees a leopard or a lion, it will alarm call, that sort of barking. When they see wild dogs, they don't even bother, they just run. They don't alarm call, they just take off at 100 miles an hour. Still definitely off the reserve, but we'll head to the airstrip anyway. There are some impalas. Stop and have a quick look at them with a waterbuck. Say when, Andrew, is that work for you?
For the impala, yeah.
Okay. So we've got some bachelor herd of impala here. And all these bachelors, oh, there are a couple of females there too, but you can see the bachelors are tolerating each other's presence now. And the females are all pregnant, if they're going to be pregnant this year. We'll have little baby impalas growing in them for the next 6.5 months. And it's the most wonderful time. If you're still around in November, it's well worth watching us and watching the lambs as they come out. A ubiquitous fork-tailed drongo. Thank you, William, for pointing out that I don't know why it has a fork tail. Must find out about that. And there is a waterbuck. There are two of them, actually. There's another one just in front. And the reason that they will hang around with the impala is for vigilance, for safety. There are quite a few animals that will do that. They will lurk around impala because they're so vigilant and so good at spotting predators. And obviously if you're a bull on your own and you don't have a herd, that is an excellent strategy. If I was living in the bush alone, I would definitely hang around some impala. I wouldn't have to keep my eyes open all the time. I'm just going to be silent for a second. You can actually hear them all grazing. You can just hear their little mouths tearing at the fresh shoots that they can find. Not many fresh shoots at this time of the year. So they'll browse quite a lot at this time of the year, will the impalas. And the bush and the waterbuck, of course. And there are actually three waterbuck bulls in front of us. This will be a small bachelor herd of bulls that are definitely very territorial. The around water are the mature bulls, and so young bulls will struggle to maintain any kind of territory. I'm going to sneak a little bit forward just to keep you updated. The pack of dogs is still, I'm afraid, far off here. It's quite nice there. I'm sorry. Throwing Andrew around a bit. There we go. He's actually a fairly magnificent bull, this. I suspect because there are one or two sort of waterholes on this reserve, but I suspect because there are only sort of one or two, you'll probably find a big territorial bull somewhere around each, and even relatively mature bulls like this one we're looking at now will be forced into some kind of bachelor herd where they will have to live with the boys because it's just too difficult. There's not enough sort of in the way of separate water holes for them all to have a territory around. There you can see eating quite long grass. That's nice to see. We often wonder which pieces of the grass they eat, and if you look carefully there, they're not selecting any of the stalks on which the seeds grow. So he's selecting specifically the leaves. They are dry, but they are the leafy part at the bottom of the grass, or a little bit higher up from the ground than the impala might feed. And remember, the drier the grass gets, the more crucial becomes the need to drink. There are some impala alarm calling, but a long way away. That's what made that waterbuck lift his head there. Beautiful bird song now, as the sort of relaxed nature of the midday, of the mid-morning, starts to infuse the bush around us. Andrew, I just want to sneak forward and just see if we can't see what bird that is making that call. Oh, there, you can actually see it there, or one of them. Can you look, can you see on the front there, black and white bird? Well spotted. Very sweet little fellow there. That was one of those grey-crowned helmet shrikes that we had earlier. Okay, let's sneak a little bit forward. Right. waterbuck bulls in there. We'll go past them now. It's a real old bachelor group of these chaps. It's actually very interesting. I've seen far more waterbuck bulls and far more buffalo bulls than I have females of either species. And that's odd, I think. There's a little raptor up on that dead log, that dead tree there, Andrew. Can you see that?
I see him.
Oh, that's lovely. I don't know how close in can we can get. Is that it?
That's how close I can get, yeah.
Sorry, that's as close as in as we can get. That is called a lizard buzzard. Lizard buzzard. Unsurprisingly, little meat-eating bird that eats lizards, amongst other things. I'll show you a picture of him, for those of you who can't see him properly. You see the lizard buzzard. I'm going to have another look in case I'm telling you a lie, which I think I might be. Yes, he's so fluffed out that it's because of the cold. I think I have lied to you. I apologize for that. He is in fact a gabbar goshawk. Is he? Yes, I think he's a gabbar goshawk. Ooh, dear. I'm getting myself confused here. I'm going to have one more look with my powerful binoculars, which are not quite powerful enough. He is a lizard buzzard, that is correct. Looking for lizards. Not very big. We'll show you a picture of him now. Find him again. There he is. Number one there. That's him there. Pink legs, pink beak, important distinguishing features. He's barred from his chest down. And he's, well, pinkish legs and beak and sear. The sear is the top of the beak, where the nostrils are, and that's what he's got. And I mean, I'm pretty sure that's what he is. Were he to fly off, and we'd be able to see because of the two flashes of white there that you'll see on his tail. There he goes. He's diving down into the ground. Hopefully he's caught himself a lizard. I don't think he'll fly back. Oh, there he goes. Flown off, but not back to the same place, unfortunately. Sorry about that, Andrew. Right, let us move slowly along. Hello, Derek on Twitter. You postulate that perhaps, and this is a good one, I'm just not entirely convinced of it. You say that perhaps the fork-tailed drongo has got that specific tail design because he's acrobatic in flight. He is acrobatic in flight, but so is the square-tailed. But there might be some form of acrobatic advantage that tail does give him and her. Yeah, it's possible. So if I think of the flight of the fork-tailed drongo, especially if they are mobbing or attacking sort of predatory birds, they are excellent at flying up and then flipping over and coming back down again. I don't know if maybe that's what the fork tail helps them to do. Okay, right, now we're going to drive to the southern end of this airstrip and see if we can't maybe pick up the dogs. I'm pretty sure that they're still south of us. And while we do that, we're going to cross over to Brent, who I believe is flummoxing a few of you with his plant quiz. We'll see you a little bit later.
Everyone, we're still on the hunt for some of the remaining tree species. We got one more, I think, that's going to sort of tie up with the other two. So we're going to keep looking for that. We are still checking this area that possibly Sindile could be in. I haven't seen any tracks yet, unfortunately, though. But we will keep checking. California. Billy, welcome on the Sunrise Safari. Billy has asked about that lion track I saw a bit earlier, and I said it was a bit confusing and I didn't think it was particularly fresh. It is quite difficult on that road because it is a main access road. The edge of the tracks become quite worn. I'll try and get to a spot where we can see some tracks nicely and I'll show you how a track ages. And the little things we look at to see the age of tracks. Obviously there's quite obvious things like if another animal has walked over the top, especially like your nocturnal animals, so civets, genets, and those type of things. Oh, there's actually a little bird we struggle to get in the camera sometimes. Just if we zoom in on that fallen down log there, there's two of them hopping around there, and there's a little chinspot batis as well. I've tried quite a few times to get them on camera. We'll just wait for them to hop up. And the other's just off to the left. I'm going to try edge a little bit. There we go. Just wait. Hop up. Be a good little... There he is. Definitely one of my favorite little birds while I'm walking through the bush. They make quite a lot of noise. Very distinct black and white. I know it's a very difficult sighting. Oh, there's a little chinspot batis in front. Not who we're after at the moment. Try edge a little bit there. There you see him flapping. There you go. There he is. Very difficult. I'm going to try to get a little bit closer now. I've tried to get them on camera a few times, but they are quite busy little birds. And normally always in pairs, and the other one has flown off already. And so is that one, but there the two of them are. In that tree at the back there. Here we go. There he is. Oh, to the right, took off. There, up to the right. Out in the open, up to the right. Come out of it. There we go. There we go. That's definitely the best view we've had of this bird. I wonder if you could tell me what this bird is. You can see he's looking for insects and spiders. checking very carefully. Very busy little birds. This is definitely the best sighting I've had on them since I've been on the live drives. Because they are so busy, they're quite often difficult to get into the shot. Chum. As you can see, he doesn't sit still for very long. See if I can try to get it to come a bit closer. There we go, top of screen. There we go. Psh, 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 psh. Psh, 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 psh. Psh, 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 psh. No, not paying any attention to my alarm calls. Continuing feeding. If you do know what bird this is, let me know. You can do that by sending your answers to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. It's got a very sort of zit-zit-zit-zit-zit call. They're not making it at the moment, too busy feeding. And off it goes. Well done, nice Phil. So, I wonder who knows what that one is. Looks like no one's checked this road yet this morning, which is always a positive for me, because I get to see what's been happening first on the tracks. California, welcome on the Sunrise Safari. John would like to know if I've got any information about whether that young male lion is still with the Nkuhumas. The last time I saw them, John, he was. I'm not 100% sure whether if he still is at the moment. But I will try to find out during the course of the day. To Joanne in Arizona, who has got that bird spot on. It was a southern black tit, and strangely enough, it seems like James was also showing you southern black tits this morning. And also Judith on Twitter was the first with the southern black tit. We've had some more information from Sam about frog hopper beetles or spittle bugs, and Sam was just letting me know that it can't be a beetle due to the fact of it's how its mouth parts work. I did know that, Sam, thanks very much for that, but the colloquial term for them in this part of the world and in quite a few of the insect books is that of a frog hopper beetle. Although scientifically incorrect, like quite a few of the common names, it is the sort of local common name for them, a frog hopper beetle. So, but thanks very much, Sam. And hopefully when the summer months come, we can definitely try find some. So I'm just going to have a quick look at this junction for tracks and see if we can find a nice track that we can show you to how tracks age. Just to follow up with Billy from California, who was wondering how we age tracks. So I'm going to try and find some really fresh tracks of any animal, and then I'll try age them for you. If we get many monitor lizards in the area. We do, Connor. We get two very distinct types. We have the water or Nile monitor that we find around the dams and water points in the reserve. And then we have the rock monitor, which is a more sort of terrestrial species, and it lives in dead trees and holes. Oh, hello. There's quite a few animals off to the left here, including some warthog. Just going to move around to where we can possibly see them. This also, they are moving through, so I'm going to try and get ahead of them so they move into frame. Look at those biggies. Gone into a bit of a dip. Well, we'll wait for the warthog. There's some kudu and impala. Feeding on the edge of this seep line. Oh, there's some more warthogs. Lots of warthogs around here this morning. So we got a nice group of kudu. A few young ones in there. Some adult females. I can't see any adult males. Just waiting for the warthogs to walk out into the open. There comes one now. We're quite close to the old hyena den that's not being used at the moment. There's, we'll have a look, the warthog's gonna, there he is, warthog. Come to the left a little bit, behind that bush willow. But heading this way, and there's another kudu in the background there.
I think so, female.
And the warthog seems to have stopped. There's a few more warthogs that are just quite difficult to see. There we go. Phil's got them. So there we go. Quite a nice little section of general game here. We've got kudu, warthog, impala. Oh, something spooked everyone. I'm not sure what it was. I don't think it was us. I think one of the warthogs might have had a slight panic, as they do from time to time. Not being as tall as everyone else, they can't see as well. And general rule with animals, if one runs, all run.
I think the best way for me to be able to do this, I've been trying to figure out the best way to show you a track nicely, is if I use my boot and then age that so we can go from really fresh. Just gonna try and find where to... I'm gonna have to try figure out where we don't get any shade from the vehicle. I'm gonna do this. I'm just gonna pop off and go stand on the road so you guys are able to see, and also take this opportunity to shed a layer or two. Here we go. Okay, so you let me know where's good for you, Phil. So you're going to be able to get my foot, and I'm going to go down. Okay, so here we go. How's my audio? Okay, so you can see there's a nice, fresh Brent track. And one of the ways we would age tracks, Billy, is if we looked for specific species that leave other tracks. So in the early morning, the first bird on the road is an emerald-spotted wood dove. And if there were tracks going across, need something a bit thicker. So if there were tracks going across my boot track like that, I would know that that track was from the night, because the emerald spotted wood doves would have been the first to cross in the morning. And you do the same with civet tracks, that will mean it was later in the night. And then another big thing that ages tracks is wind. Now you can see that my track, the edges aren't sharp. So now I start thinking that possibly this track is a little bit older, maybe even from yesterday, and there's been wind during the day, or dust from a vehicle driving past that's covered it and stopped those defined edges. But now you look at my other fresh track there, and nice sharp edges, very nicely defined, compared to this, which is now looking like it's been there for a while. Well, I hope that helps a little bit, Billy, with you understanding how we age tracks. Let's continue on for a bit and see what else is out there. So, while we continue on looking for that last tree species, that for a very special question we're going to do a little bit later, I went across to James and see what he's been up to on Arathusa.
Yeah. A good day. Hello everyone, welcome back to Wendy. We have found some buffalo. They're just south of the road here. Andrew is going to pan to them. And I was talking earlier about how unusual I have found it that there seem to be very few herds of females in this area. Large bachelor herds of buffalo. I've never seen buffalo, bachelor herds of buffalo this often. And I'm not really sure why that is. So again, any theories that might come through from the Twitterverse would be great. Like that one about the drongo's tail, which I think is a good one, now that I think of it. So bachelor bulls, all on their own. Some of them, I mean, now this is for the less squeamish, or for the more squeamish, this won't be an ideal sort of thing to look at. But what you can see on some of them is that the scrotum has almost atrophied. And that normally happens when the bull is no longer sort of a breeding age. But a lot of these bulls are definitely still of breeding age, and they really are wasting their time around here if they're seeking opportunities. Apparently there is a herd of females quite far to the north of where we are, but I've only seen one herd of females come through here. And by females, I mean breeding herds, so there is a herd that has got bulls in it as well. But these old boys, and they're not so old, half of them, seem to hang out on their own. I saw a little herd of bachelors yesterday with a very young bull who was barely an adult. So what you find is that it might be, I'll tell you what the reason might be, is that the young bulls who can't have mating opportunities because they're not big enough yet, and the older bulls who are just perhaps not quite strong enough to compete for mating opportunities anymore, they find that it's easier to live on their own. They don't have to move as far, and they don't have to deal with the nagging of the children in the herd, and they can sort of move in a smaller area. They need water, they need grazing, but they don't have to worry too much about moving around like the big herds do, because the grazing is obviously, the bigger the herd, the further they're going to have to walk to find food. So that's perhaps why. So the young and old, I suspect it has everything to do with mating opportunities. So the younger you are, obviously you're not big enough, and then when you get just beyond prime age, you start to lose a bit of strength, and it becomes difficult to maintain mating opportunities. These are still very powerful animals, though. Lions will think twice before taking on something this size. In fact, I've seldom heard or seen kills of buffalo where there haven't been mature male lions involved in the kill.
This one's got a white eye.
It does seem to have a white eye. Is that not just the camera? No, it's not. That's right, Andrew. Can you see that, everyone? He's got a white eye. So it looks like a cataract from here. I'm no ophthalmologist, but it's either a cataract, or more likely what's happened is that he's spiked it on a thorn, and that has probably rendered it blind. I suspect that he cannot see out of that eye. It is watering slightly. Ugh. It does not look comfortable. Now, when people talk about buffalo being dangerous, I, of course, don't like to use the term dangerous at all out here. Potentially dangerous is as far as I'm prepared to go. But an animal like that, you see, might turn into a potentially dangerous animal because he will feel threatened by the fact that he can't see. And as soon as an animal becomes threatened, well, then they start to become a lot more nervous. And when they become nervous, they become potentially dangerous. And so if he can only see through one eye, I mean, he's the kind of animal you might walk into by mistake during the night, and he'll get a fright more easily, perhaps, than some of the others. Lots of scratching about, and the ubiquitous fork-tailed drongo is never far behind a herd like this. There's one just behind the one that's scratching himself there on a tree. I don't think Andrew will pick him up behind all of the bushes. You can see the red on the top of that one's horns as he's scratching, and that's from scratching against slightly bigger trees, often marula trees, or there you can hear the oxpeckers coming in. Right, I think we're going to, what these bulls will do now is sort of lie down in the shade and chew their cud, and they'll move off to have a drink later in the day, I'm sure, and then they'll just rest for most of the rest of the day. So we're going to leave them to that as the heat starts to build quite nicely. Andrew is still dressed like a bank robber with a sort of a thermoregulation issue. I have shed at least three layers by this stage of the morning. We're going to head up towards, there's a waterhole just up ahead on the off chance that a bevy of elephants has come down there, but who knows. Luck has not been with Wendy today. And I just did want to tell you, and thank you for telling Brent that we had seen the southern black tit. Kadria, William, Chris and Safari, thank you very much for your contributions on the design of the fork-tailed drongo's tail. You seem to confirm that it does have something to do with maneuverability and aerodynamics. So I think let's go with that theory for now. And now let's try and find out or think about what it is specifically about the drongo's flight that necessitates that forked tail. Now, I suppose the best way to do that or to find out would be to check if we can't find another bird that has a similar design and have a look at what its sort of strategy is for flight, or to just observe a drongo in flight. And what I, like I said to you, the one very characteristic thing that they seem to be able to do, and I don't think I've seen other birds do, is almost do like a backflip. So they'll take off. They'll bomb, say there's a brown snake eagle sitting on a marula tree, they'll bomb that brown snake eagle and then flip up and over and down. And I wonder if there's something in that fork-tailed design that allows them to be able to do that backflip. I'm guessing entirely here. Thank you very much for your contributions. Like I say to you quite often, I tend to learn as much on these things, that on these drives, as you do. On Twitter, thank you for your question, a good one. Do oxpeckers alarm call? Nice question, because it's important. I'm just going backwards here, not because I'm trying to be artistic about my answer, but because I've seen some leopard tracks. Unfortunately, they go next door and they're not very new. I believe Brent showed you how to age some tracks, and those ones were pretty indistinct. Even though they're in the sand, that makes them pretty difficult to age, but they were pretty indistinct. So, Shorty, if that is indeed your name, I have been called that from time to time. Oxpeckers do alarm call. They make like a buzzing sound, that sound that you heard there when they were coming in to land, is the alarm call is very similar to that. And it's important because when you're walking in the bush and you hear that alarm call, they'll often alarm call the predators, which will put the animals that they're sitting on, so like those buffalo, on high alert. And what you don't want is to blunder into some buffalo or rhino when you're walking. And so you listen very carefully out for that alarm call, and they'll alarm call at us, which warns the animals that they're sitting on. So it's a really nice early warning signal for us as well. Good question. Deborah in Kentucky, I've never been asked this before. Thank you for your question. You seem to be a keen rangeland scientist, and you're quite interested in that grass that we were looking at on the termite mound called Chloris roxbergiana. Chloris is spelled, if I'm not mistaken, I'm a horrific speller, C-H-L-O-R-S, that's C-H-L-O-R-S, and roxbergiana is R-O-X-B-U-R-G-H. I-A-N-A. So R-O-X-B-U-R-G-H, Roxburgh, and then I-A-N-A. Chloris roxburghiana. Virginia Beach, thank you. You seem to have definitively solved the fork-tailed drongo problem. There's one flying here, Andrew. Let's just try and get him while we talk about this. Sorry, he's gone a bit further. William in Virginia Beach, you say that you have found that a fork-tail, well, not that you found, that you found research that says a fork-tail like that, with a an angle of 120 degrees, I think it was, is the almost universally accepted optimum for flight maneuverability, especially with in terms of pitch and yaw, which I think, if I understand correctly, pitches would be up and down, and yaw would be from side to side. So it would seem that the fork is for that, especially when spread. What I suspect is, therefore, that, and in fact, I think of a crowned eagle in flight. It doesn't have a very straight tail when it's spread out. They've probably also got a bit of a fork there. And so while the fork-tailed drongo has a permanent fork, I suspect some of the other very maneuverable birds then can probably fork their tails almost at will. That is fascinating information, and I'm glad we've had such a great discussion on it. And Safari, you want to know what a fork-tailed drongo eats, which of course ties in with the discussion on its flight. A fork-tailed drongo will hawk insects from a perch. So what they do is they'll sit on a perch, and as an insect flies out, they'll grab it. And the other, so it helps to be very maneuverable. Sorry, I know the other bird that has often have fork tails are the bee eaters, which are like little fighter jets. So they also can move, they also hawk insects in the air, and their maneuverability is obviously enhanced by that forked tail. And the other thing that the drongo has, of course, is the whiskers on the side of its beak, which allow it, which sort of help to knock insects into its beak. Indeed, and some people have pointed out that swallows have forked tails. In North America, they have them here too. Not sort of pronouncedly forked, but sort of curved like that. And that obviously, they're some of the most maneuverable birds in the world. And also, of course, use hawk insects out of the air. Thank you all for your contributions, and that really is fascinating to me. We're going to cross over to Brent and just see what he's managed to find. And we're going to head off to the waterhole, and we'll see you just now.
Welcome back, everyone. And as I said a little bit earlier, I was going to try find a rain tree where we can discuss the noise it makes, or the apple leaf. So we found one here that is
We found quite a lot, but they were all way too big for me to do anything with and try to see if I can make the noise of the tree making rain. But here we have one that's been pushed over by elephants, it looks like. So if you're ready, I'm going to go pretend to be the wind through the tree. And also the last member of our plant for the medicinal part is there. So here we go. Let's try pretend to be the rain. Try and find a good spot to climb. And hopefully the mic picks up the noise of the leaves. So right now we're gonna try and listen. I don't do quite as good a job as the wind. I'm gonna try shake. Not quite the same as the real thing, I'm afraid, but as a kid, for me, it really sounded like rain, but maybe not so much. But the last plant as well. I sneak back. Okay, I'm back after making myself look like a bit of a baboon in the tree. Prepare myself here. We got a very nice question in from Sandy in Virginia, and she wanted me to see if there were any medicinal plants. Sorry, I think my ears are caught on something here. There we go, that would make sense. Sandy from Indiana. That was the tree at the back there. That is a silver cluster leaf. So since that's the last tree we've got, we'll start with it. So we have the branch here. And Sandy's question was specifically about medicinal plants that could be used to treat open wounds. So I've got quite a nice book that specifically deals with the medicinal uses of trees. So we did a little bit of research while we were off air. And here we go, we have a silver cluster leaf. And this is used in tropical Africa, so not so much down here, to treat open wounds. And the way they're prepared is, the leaves are actually mixed in and crushed into a paste, sometimes with mealie meal, and then applied to the wound. So unfortunately, we don't have all the tools to actually try and make the concoction here, but it is, the leaves are crushed and I suppose ground with a pestle probably, so ground into a paste, and they'll probably use, let me just check here, maybe a bit of fat or oil in that to get a bit of a sticky substance to it, and then that would be placed on the open wound. Interestingly enough, that used more common in this part of the world to treat eye infections and for pneumonia. And the bark is taken as for diabetes. So the bark again is ground with a pestle into a paste, into a fine powder once it's a bit dry, and then that is taken as a control for diabetes. So that was one of the three species that is used for open wounds that we see quite regularly in this area. And the other one is one we all know very well, and it is a buffalo thorn. And you can see there's very distinct one straight thorn, one hooked thorn, So a very important species, not only spiritually from a lot of African cultures, but also medicinally. So it's a decoction of the roots, and roots and leaves are basically boiled and then also ground into a paste again, and they're applied externally on the body to boils and open wounds, glandular swellings as well, but not only for healing, but also for pain relief. So here's another one, and when we know more about the sort of spiritual side, we speak about how the hook thorn captures the spirit of a deceased relative that has died far away from their home, and then the straight thorn releases that spirit back into the traditional home. But we've spoken about that quite often. We haven't really done the other medicinal things. Roots are also used as a remedy for diarrhea and dysentery. Apart from all of that, the leaves are edible and can be used in salad. This one I'm not going to eat today because I picked it up off a main road, so I think I'd get more dust than leaf. So I'm not going to chew this one today. Don't feel like having a mouthful of sand. And then the third and final one is also quite a common species we see. It looks a lot like an acacia, but when I was explaining that it doesn't have thorns, it's got spines. So spines are modified branchlets that have become into a sharp edge that are used to help protect the tree. And it is quite, its common name is a sickle bush, or sometimes called a Chinese lantern tree, and I'll show you why it's called the Chinese lantern tree a little later. Here we go. Let's just see how they put it together. There we go. Ash from the incinerated seed pods, together with roots of two other flowers, a brachyrhynchus and a solanum, are mixed with Vaseline, so also like a fat-based or oil-based thing, and applied to wounds. And very, very interesting. That also has a pain relief facet with them. It's used quite a lot for quite a lot of things. Toothache, backache, syphilis, leprosy. It's used as a purgative, an aphrodisiac. Also used as a sort of traditional, the roots are ground up and mixed with other plants to use for infertility. So a fertility drug. And quite interesting. So this book goes a little bit more in depth. So the dried fruits are shown to have an antimicrobial activity. So there is a bit of sort of a healing in it. But I'll show you now what the seeds look like and why it's sometimes called a Chinese lantern tree. So the seeds of the sickle bush are very sickly and roundly shaped. And we don't have any at this time of the year. But there we go. That's the... And then if we go a little bit to the right, you'll see the flowers. They're said to look like Chinese lanterns. So when this tree is in flower, it's very, very pretty, and there'll be a lot of them. You can see up in the top, look like little lanterns hanging off the tree. So Sandy from Indiana, I hope that helps answer your question about the different tree species we get here that are used medicinally. I can now deposit these back into the bush. But now where's that buffalo thorn? Did I get the buffalo thorn? Because knowing my luck, it's the one I would sit on. Well, it looks like it's escaped, so hopefully I don't end up with a thorn in my bottom. Have a quick look, but we're not far from the hyena den, so we're going to have a quick look at see if anyone's at home. We've checked quite a few times and we haven't had any luck yet, but hopefully this morning our luck is changing. William just made a comment that the tree sounded more like rain than the cokey. Franklin sounded like it was saying cokey. Well, thanks very much for that, William. William also would like to know whether it's type A or type B diabetes and whether it is gestational. William, I'm not 100% sure, but I will have to go through this book and see if it does mention whether it is type A or type B diabetes. Maybe we'll, if there's some hyenas there, I'll have a quick look while we get to the hyena, or once we're at the hyena den. So everyone get your eyes ready. Remember, quite often the adult hyenas might not lie right next to the den. They'll be around, so we're looking for ear flicks, a tail flick to try to keep the flies away, even a slight little bit of movement, or shade, a different body shape in the grass or in the shade. Jim, welcome on the Sunrise Safari, Jim. I'm going to get to your question in a second, Jim. I just want to have a quick look around this hyena den. There are quite a lot of fresh tracks, and I did come here yesterday, so on top of my tracks. So hopefully someone's at home. Okay, we got to go really quickly to James. He's got something really exciting. So we'll be back with you in a little bit.
Hello, everybody. Look, we've just spotted, well, I didn't spot, Andrew spotted those honey badgers. I'm just going to be quiet. They don't like my voice. Isn't that spectacular? A mother and her pup, it looks like. And they've got something in their mouths. I don't know what they're eating. Come on, come back. Oh, that's beautiful. Isn't that wonderful? Look at the size of the claws. Andrew, can you get them?
Fully zoomed.
The little baby. To stay as low to the ground as possible, the little one is. The honey badger is not scared of much, so they've obviously assessed that we're not too much of a threat, so now they're coming a bit closer. They definitely had found something in the sand there that they were eating. As we spotted them, Andrew said, this beats a herd of elephants. And I suppose it does, because we so rarely see them. The little one is still crouching to the ground. Look at that trot. Tail up. And they'll produce a very foul, skunk-like smell if they are threatened. Sorry, Andrew, I don't think if I move forward, it's not going to get you an any better picture, I'm afraid. Oh, that's just great. What a special thing to see. Incredibly powerful animal for the size. Very loose skin, so that when something like a lion takes hold of them or tries to take hold of them, they basically just get a handful of skin like you would with a dog, like a staffy or the scruff of a cat's neck, but they're like that all the way around. There's a Franklin there. It has either not seen them or is not particularly worried about them. Tremendous claws. Well, I think they've pretty much left us now. Great spot, Andrew. I was waffling away about birds' tails when Andrew spotted them. William, I believe you have called this the holy grail of sightings. Thank you for that. I tend to agree with you today, especially. Spectacular. Called a honey badger, apparently because they do like to eat honey, and they do like to eat the larvae of bees. And the big story, of course, is that of the honey badger and the honey guide, which is a bird that comes along and will sit above you and chirp. Its normal call, or the greater honey guide, which is the most common one here, is a call that goes Victor, Victor, Victor. But when it wants you to follow it, and when it goes and it finds an animal like that, it sits above them and chirrs. Andrew says its head is over there. So while I continue to waffle, it's just behind that that log there in the distance. That movement you can see in the grass there is the honey badger. They might come back. I'm seriously tempted to cut a piece off Andrew and just put it there and see if it doesn't tempt them to come out from hiding. Anyway, that bird will then lead the badger. That chirring call is basically saying, follow me, follow me. And the bird will then follow the badger. The badger will then follow the bird, to a beehive. There he is, looking up over the top. And once the beehive has been found, the badger will use those tremendous claws to tear open whatever piece of wood that it happens to be in, exposing the bees, and the badger, because of its skin, is totally immune to the bees' stings, and it will eat on the honeycomb, and the bird's reward is to eat on the bee larvae. That's what they like to eat. And that's why it's called a honey badger. But they'll eat anything. I mean, they'll eat any kind of meat. They're definitely a carnivore. They'll probably eat the odd bit of fruit, but they'll eat termites and mice and ants and squirrels and a bit of carrion here and there, lizards and snakes. They'll definitely eat snakes. And anything they can get their teeth or claws into. Marvelous. And very unusual to see them in the day. I mean, I've seen them a few times at night, but mainly very seldom during the day. So I'm afraid they've you can just see them through there. I'm afraid if I drove in there, they'd run away very fast. So we can't really get any closer. It'd be nice to move that tree out of the way, but if I went in on foot, they'd definitely run away. Deborah in Kentucky and Marianne in Boston and various other others in the Twitterverse. Deborah, I think you said you've been watching the show for 9 years and have never seen a badger before. Well, I'm so glad that situation has been remedied by our faithful cameraman, Mr. Andrew, who's now quivering with excitement instead of cold. Isn't that wonderful as it sticks its head up through there? He's just checking, she's just checking, to make sure we're not causing any trouble. I think, Marianne, in Boston, you said they look a bit like skunks. They do look a bit like American skunks, but they don't come from the same family as far as I'm aware. No, in fact, they do. They're from a family, well, they come, it's same sort of, same suborder, they call the caniformia, or the dogs. And this is the family that they come from is called the mustelid, or mustelidae, and that's the badgers and our weasels and the striped polecat. Now, striped polecat is basically our form of a skunk, and your skunk in North America comes from a family called the Mephitidae. We don't get any of those here, but similar sort of, same order, same suborder. Hello, Rick and Susie. You ask a lovely question. You're sitting in Hawaii. Lord knows what time it is there at this time of the day. I'm not sure if you're in tomorrow or still in yesterday. But welcome to it, and we're very happy to have you along. And lovely question. I think I know exactly where it comes from. There's a wonderful documentary about badgers where a badger gets bitten by, I think it's... a snouted cobra. It may even be an Egyptian cobra, and or a puff adder. Anyway, one of those snakes, and the badger seems to weaken, and then collapses and lie and sort of goes into a coma. And after, I'm not sure how long it is. I think it's about 3 or 4 or 5 hours. It wakes up, shakes its head, gets up, and trots off exactly like you just saw her trot off there. So somehow the body of that badger processes this tremendously awful venom. I think it must have been a cobra because I think it was neurotoxic venom. And badger gets up and walks off. So yes, Rick and Susie, that you are remembering correctly, that it did happen in that documentary. And I'm pretty sure that they can. Their bodies are just able to process the proteins that are in those venoms that we certainly couldn't. Curious one, you have a good question. Do honey badgers den? The answer is yes, they do. They will make a den, just like so many of the other animals out here, in a termite mound, smaller hole than the hyenas or wild dogs will use, obviously. And in fact, I suspect that this female and her pup were seen going into, there was a den just around here, not too long ago, that I've checked out a few times and not seen anything there. And I suspect that's where she and this pup were. I think at this age, though, probably out of the den and wouldn't be, they might go back to it to rest, but otherwise they'll find some thick bush to hide in. Still there, Andrew?
Still there.
I think Andrew might have a better view than the rest of us.
I wonder if you can do that call again.
Which call?
The honey guide.
You think he came out?
I saw his head pop up. Maybe.
So we're just doing the honey guide call there. Andrew says he reckons that's what made her stick her head up. I'm not convinced myself. We haven't managed to induce her to do it. And we have a question from Dia in Miami, Florida. Thank you for your question. You want to know, do they have a family unit like a human being, or is it the female that does all the raising of the babies? There are no animals out here that have a family unit like a human being, really. And I'm afraid the onus of raising the young falls entirely on the mother, as you saw it there.
trying to see if we can't draw him out with some sort of alarm call. I'll try a dwarf mongoose. Well, not quite a dwarf mongoose. I'll make a sort of generic mongoosey type call. Definitely lifting her head now. Should we try and just go a little bit up the hill here? We might get a view down through there. In fact, I'm not going to move until you've lost her completely. I think it might be now. Liz in Wisconsin, are they related to wolverines? And now the wolverine, as far as I understand it, is probably related. I think it's from the same family. I have an excellent little book with me that I will check in right now for you. Certainly the same suborder as we were looking at there. And I'm going to stop here and see if we can't spot her through there. Liz, let me get back to you immediately. I see no reference to the wolverine here, I'm afraid.
Oh, here they come.
Here they come. So I'll have to get back to you on that. Liz, sorry, this car is about to disappear down the road. Sorry about that, Andrew.
Okay.
Hello, Laura. You want to know if I've ever seen a honey badger take on a lion? No, I haven't, but I've definitely heard of it happening, and I know people who have seen them. Oh, look at that. That's just spectacular. I've heard of them not taking on a lion, but certainly defending themselves successfully against a lion attack because of those vicious claws that they've got, and they're incredibly strong for their height. They do get killed every so often by lions, but most other animals other than lions will avoid them. I've never seen it personally, though. Disappearing into the undergrowth again. Liz, I will get back to you on your wolverine question. No doubt the Twitterverse will be able to find out immediately, but I don't see a reference to a wolverine here. I suspect it's part of the suborder Caniformia, or the dogs.
Oh, they're going to cross the road up there.
They're going to cross the road, really?
Yeah.
And we can still see them, so I'm going to go forward quite quickly. Andrew's spotted a road somehow. The advantage of height, I suppose. Now, we don't want to go too fast because then we'll frighten them. Andrew, if you see them, will you shout?
Yeah.
Well, don't shout, just indicate with great enthusiasm. Lion tracks on this road.
Yeah, I got them.
You got them?
Yeah.
Forward, back?
A little bit back.
Well, there they are. I spotted. Say when.
That's good.
Andrew, yet again, is on fire.
know what it is, of course, is that I don't let him smoke on the vehicle, so his brain functions perfectly. Oh, that's wonderful. Everybody, and we've only got 2 minutes left in theory, so for those of you who have to go and get on with your lives, thank you so much for joining us. It's been a wonderful morning, especially this latterly. Now we're going to stay with these honey badgers if you have still have the time, so those of you who have to leave, I'm sorry, we'll see you later this afternoon. Thank you for your contributions and your questions and everything else like that, and especially as we look at this kind of benchmark sighting for WildEarth, our first honey badger sighting. Kadria, a special shout out to you who's been with us for 9 years from the very beginning. I mean, that is astonishing. Thank you for your support and for your continued contributions. So for those of you who have to go, bye-bye and have a marvelous night, morning, day, evening, wherever it is you might be. Thank you for watching. And we're going to try and stay with them for a little bit longer for those who can, and then we'll head off. I don't think that they're going to be particularly confiding. Andrew, should we go back a bit?
Yeah, I've lost them now.
We do seem to have lost them. I'm just going to go back a little bit. They went, looking behind us, we can't see them. Going to drive off road because the crunching will definitely make them run away. I'm afraid I think that's it. But what a spectacular sighting that was. So we'll make our way slowly out of here. So Romay, you ask, are we gonna have one more question on the hyena, on the honey badgers? You want to know, would a honey badger ever be killed by a hyena? Yeah, possibly. It's possible. I mean, a hyena is a pretty brave thing, pretty strong, pretty big, pretty powerful. But if it was a group of hyenas, absolutely certainly it would be a threat. But, you know, a honey badger is not exactly a delicious meal for anything. So it's quite a dangerous meal. It's a bit like it's a bit like a baboon to a leopard. Baboons are apparently quite tasty for leopards, but it's a real risk to try and catch them because of their teeth and their size. And it's a bit like that with the honey badger and the hyenas. And Julie in California, you want to know why they're out in the day. I suspect they were out in the cool morning, and all that happened was that the sun came up and it became
light, and they just kept finding little bits and pieces to eat. So when we found them, or when Andrew spotted them, as you saw, he was, or the female was eating something, and I'm sure the baby obviously doesn't have a choice whether it can go to bed or not. But basically, they will choose to move in the crepuscularly or into the nighttime. But if there's food around during the day and they happen to be moving during the morning and they find food, well, then they'll be out. And especially if they don't feel threatened. I think the big male lion track we saw up there was probably from yesterday. So, everybody, that's it. Thank you for staying with us, especially if you ran over time with us. We're going to head off to have breakfast. Andrew is about to expire from a lack of food and cold. He's used a lot of food in his generation of heat in his body today. I'm feeling fairly peckish myself after watching those badgers having an eat. So we're going to head off. Thank you again for all your contributions and questions. Especially love the discussion on bird tails. I shall go and do some further research there. And we'll also try and find out if the honey badger is related to the wolverine. Have a marvelous day, evening, morning, whatever part of the day you happen to find yourself. And we will see you a little bit later this afternoon.